Hello. I'm Eddie Burns and we're off on another adventure. Starting in Milngavie and heading for Drymen on the West Highland Way. It's about 12 miles, quite a bit for an old guy like me. We'll see how we go. Signs all over the place here, none of which say the West Highland Way, and you think, oh my god, which way do we go? And at this point it actually doesn't matter, because both of them join up in roughly the same place. But there is a proper sign, a West Highland Way sign. It's a wooden post with a little yellowish symbol on it. I'll show you one. So there's one there. The symbol is white. It's a little kind of thistle symbol-y thing. And this one's also got a yellow arrow on it, just telling us that this is the way we go. But don't rely on these signs all the time, because sure as fate, when you're at some sort of path division, there's no sign. But most of the time, it's not too bad. Anyway, it goes from here through a park, and then it goes up this steep bit here, and then it goes along here before arriving in a state of some mild sweatiness at, and we arrive here in mugged up wood, and that's where we're going. To be honest, it's only when I arrive in Mugged at Wood that I start to get a real feel for the West Highland Way. Up until this point, I've come a couple of miles through Mugged at Country Park, and we're still in Mugged at Country Park, but there was nothing much happening visually up until this point. But now we're in a big forest, and I know that visually forests can be a bit boring, lack of a view and all that sort of thing, but there's just something about Mugged at Wood that feels quite exciting. I mean, you know, up until this point there's been a lot of anticipation, and that's maybe fueled our desire to keep going. But when you come into Mugged at Wood, you start to get a feel that something's actually going on, and the walk starts to get more exciting than it has been. We also start to get rid of a lot of the dogs. Up until this point, the place is strewn with dogs. Folk walking more than three or four dogs at a time. I already stood on dog stuff just 2 seconds out of Milngavie. You know, but we thankfully start to see the back of them. Maybe start to get a bit of time on their own. So we'll go through the woods and I'll see you at the other side. Okay, we've come out of Mugged at Wood. You hit a wee road and turn left. I'll keep the camera on just now, we'll have a wee donder to ourselves. One thing I will say about Mugged at Wood is, whatever you do, don't be tempted to leave the track and go into the forest for a pee, because it's seriously swampy and you just might never get out again. That's my advice. We're in deep midwinter here, approaching the shortest day of the year. Not much light in a day. It's still the morning and we've got a good few hours ahead of us yet. I don't anticipate any problems. I've roughly worked out that we'll reach Drymen. I mean, I usually kind of err on the side of caution, and I've calculated that I'll reach Drymen by about 4 p.m. I would think I'll probably get there before then, but then I am stopping now and then to do this filming malarkey. So it may take me a little bit longer, but I think it's unlikely that we'll get there after four. We've had quite a bit of rain in the last few days, and as you can maybe see, the path's muddy. Okay. We've got a nice little... I always like this bit. You know, we're definitely starting to leave some of those dogs behind. If there's any dogs at this stage, then they're generally hardy ones. You know, the sort of dog that if you were to collapse and take ill, the dog would give you mouth to mouth. You know, that sort of dog. Tough ones. Anyway, I like this little kind of boardwalk thing and the reeds. It doesn't take much to keep me happy. Reeds and some wood. With this camera, it's actually got a stereo microphone. So I'm tempted to juke from one side of it to the other so that my voice will appear from one edge of the screen, and then, as if by magic, appear from the other edge of the screen. But I'll not. Apart from anything else, I keep tripping over the tripod. That's probably a good reason not to do anything fancy. Okay. I'm secretly looking for a place to pee here. There you go. I've only just said the word pee and somebody is appearing. I was going to say that I only have to stop for a pee and all of a sudden a bus load of ramblers will appear from nowhere, as if they've been maybe hiding around the corner. But, it's one of those hardy dogs. Okay, so I've had my pee. Nobody screamed, so I think I got away with it. This section of the walk, we're kind of heading in the direction of Craigallan and Loch, which is quite a nice spot. And after that, it's the Carbeth huts. There's been no great views. I mean, the scenery's been lovely, but there's just been no hills involved, or not even any sneaky peaks of hills. No pun intended. But just after the Carbeth huts, when we cross over a main road, all of a sudden the whole thing opens out, and I hope we'll get to see some pretty magnificent scenery. It'll be one of the highlights of the walk. I remember decades ago doing the West Highland Way. It was the first big walk that I tackled, and I could only do half of it. I was just very young and inexperienced, and what happened was I loaded a rucksack with essentially lots of tins of food, like beans and what have you, and it just weighed an absolute ton. And just again, rather foolishly, I walked too far. I walked from Milngavie to the youth hostel at Rowardennan. You know, it's about 26 miles or something. I mean, I was absolutely wrecked. When I got to Rowardennan in the youth hostel, all I could do was lie on my bunk and bleat. I didn't have the energy or the strength to go out to the hotel and eat or drink or whatever. I was just wrecked. And because of that first day By the time I got to Bridge of Orkney a few days later, I could go no further. I felt as if my kneecaps were travelling in a direction that they weren't meant to. I remember at the accommodation at Bridge of Orkney, or at Och, or whatever it was, and the landlady knocking my door and saying, "Would you like some tea and scones or biscuits or whatever, Mr. Burns?" But no, I was just not able to move. I was having nothing. Next day, train back home. But you learn from these things, although it would be nice if you could learn from other folks' mistakes instead of learning from your own ones. Of course, some years later, I did the second half of that walk from... I picked up where I left off at Bridge of Orkney. I walked to Fort William. But I've never actually done it in the Winnie. Yeah. Okay, so we're... We're approaching Craigallan Loch on the right. I can see the hill of Dumyat straight ahead. You probably won't be able to see it just yet, it'll be very wee. But I can see it. And it's usually round about now, after a few hours, well, not a few hours, I think we've only been walking for an hour or something. You can start to breathe a little bit. Sigh loudly. There's Craigallan Loch. Lovely. Still a bit of water. There's a fishing hut on it, where you would have kept your fishing boat in the old days. And maybe they still do, for all I know. I'm sure there's still fish in it. Well, we'll cross that road. To be honest, I'm inclined to think it's a very dangerous stretch of road for walkers, and I think somebody should be pulling their finger out and constructing a footpath along what is really a very short stretch. But it's, you know, there's a bend on it and the cars are very fast, there's no pavement, it's just, be careful. Right. We're heading for what I regard as one of the scenic highlights of this particular stretch of the West Highland Way. And it's really the first time that we'll start to see hills. And you maybe get a hint of what's going to begin on in the days to come. Because although you can see close hills like, Dumyat and the Strathblane Hills and what have you, you can also see far, far away to other hills. In fact, I think, we'll see in a moment, I think you can actually see Connick Hill at Balmaha. And, that would be for the next day. And you've got the choice of either going up Connick Hill or, I think, doing an alternative low-level part. Choice is yours. But the view from the top of Connick Hill was beautiful. Always hearkened it to a kind of looking down on a huge, partly submerged dinosaur and all these little humps peeking above the Loch Lomond with the tops of its humps. Anyway, Gordon Bennett, we've got a gate here, a great view, and we've also got a pile of horse manure. Clearly the view at this point was too much for a horse. Anyway. I'm hoping there's a cafe open, or a restaurant, or whatever you would call it. A bar even. Just on that old railway line, it's quite near the distillery. Glengoyne Distillery, I think, is its name. If it's open, we'll go in there and have some soup. We'll see you in a minute. Okay, so we're just heading for the railway line here. Again, we've got Dumgoyne straight ahead. You probably can't see it, but the Glengoyne Distillery's a white building way over to the left there. And we're heading in that direction. It's just an absolutely beautiful path there, leading towards Dumgoyne. I mean, my God, it's beautiful. Well, we're going to the left here. Okay, there's a path that leads to the distillery, where you would go and maybe get a wee sample of whiskey. Glengoyne Distillery sitting right at the foot of Dumgoyne. Well, it's 1:30, and it already feels as if the day is going. Just the way it is at this time of year. I've had my soup in the Beach Tree Inn, a little oasis there. Soup along with an assortment of animals, very small Shetland ponies, goats, and any number of other critters. I'm sure the kids love it. The soup is good. We've had the highlight, the scenic highlight for this walk between Milngavie and Drymen, and what we're getting now is going to be kind of marginally mediocre, if that's the word. In the same way that the very start of the walk was from Mogai to Mugdug Wood. Having said that, I mean, even now I can look way in the distance and see Connick Hill. I can still see it. It's getting closer and closer. Okay, I'm starting to feel a bit tired now, and I can feel the daylight fading. It's only about 2:30. And with that tiredness comes a certain lacklustre and spirit, along with doubts, because I'm seeing signs for the John Muir Way, but I'm not seeing signs for the West Highland Way, which is what I'm meant to be on. And it's been many years since I've done this stretch. I do have a map with me, but this shouldn't be a difficult section. But I think, like all these things, I'm probably worrying needlessly. And any moment now we'll just pop out onto that road that I'm expecting. So let's just see how we go. You know, while it is a long time since I've done this stretch, I have done it a fair number of times, and for some reason I've just always found this bit, I'm almost reluctant to use the word, but boring? No, I shouldn't be saying stuff like that. Oh, here's a jogger coming. Right. All systems go. I thought she was eating a nice lolly, but it's some kind of fan thing. Right, where is this road? If I don't see a road or a West Highland Way sign soon, I might start weeping. Crossed over a road there. And while there was the John Muir Way sign, there was also, thankfully, a very faded and barely recognisable West Highland Way sign. So I'm quite happy that everything's okay here. I mean, you know, I think what it does is emphasise the need to always have a Land Ranger ordnance survey map with you, to know how to use it, to read it. In addition to compass and all that carry on, I know we're not in the hills just now, but if you're suddenly not sure, and you're not sure where the sun is, or what side of the trees the lichen's growing, etc., then a compass does come in handy now and then. Having said that, if I had simply referred to the map in my rucksack, I could have avoided all this worrying. You know, I would have known exactly what was coming up and where the road that I'm looking for would be. There's a lot of little apples down there. That's a lovely smell. Apples, wee apples. Oh, anyway, so, you know, and I would have known where I was and what would be coming up. God, there's more apples. There must be a lot of apple trees here, with very small apples. Are they apples? They are, aye, crab apples, I dare say. Aye. Lovely smell. So there's a lesson to be learned there. Even for an old guy like me. It's funny how memory plays tricks on you. This bit's much longer than I remember. And I think if memory serves me well, which clearly it isn't, when we eventually reach that road that we join, I think it's a good over a mile on that. So if I'm feeling tired now, by the time I get into Drymen, it'll be a hands and knees job. Right. Well, thankfully I have joined the road that I was looking out for. And like all roads, there'll be cars on it, so be careful. We're approaching Gartness. It's road all the way from here into Drymen. I mean, I think there might be some sort of recognised turn off at Drymen, but I'm just following the road straight in. The daylight's starting to go. Gartness, it's got a slightly kind of ruined feel about it, but it's also actually very nice. Lovely little cottages. Just a lovely place, yeah. More road, more hills. Help my bob. See you shortly. Okay, we're still on this road. I have to tell you, if it's 12 miles between Milngavie and Drymen, that's a long 12 miles. And I wouldn't want to go any further. We've got a fancy sign coming up here, and this is clearly some kind of turn-off. This is where we separate from the John Muir Way, which goes that way by the looks of things. And we've got, I don't know what that is, it's a sign with Christmas stuff on it. We're going straight ahead into Drymen on this road that seems to never end. It's a never-ending road, and it goes up and down and round bends, and my God, it's long. Or maybe it just feels long. I mean, even decades ago when I used to do this, I thought this bit was long. But there's maybe some kind of, I don't know, optical illusion things happening. Oh, there's a nice sweet tunnel down there. In fact, look. Trolls Bridge. My God, what's happening down there? Okay, so not only do we have a long road to contend with, we've also got trolls. Just great. Okay, something's going on here and I don't know what it is. Trolls on a bridge and a sign pointing back towards to the Shire. What's going on here then? Right. It'll be elves next. Let's see. We're getting quite close to Drymen on this road. I've stopped here to look back. And also to catch my breath. On a top left here, you can maybe see Dumgoyne. Which we came quite close to earlier on. It's just a lovely little view back. As I say, the daylight's almost gone. Now this is probably, although it's afternoon. In fact, let me just check the time. Okay, it's 3 o'clock in the afternoon. But it feels as if, it feels like dusk. Beautiful. Okay, I'd forgotten about one final scenic extravaganza before we hit Drymen. That's Conic Hill over there. And you can actually start to see some mountains and the waters of Loch Lomond. Well, we've made it to Drymen. And the place is festooned with fairy lights. I mean, we're heading for Christmas, I suppose it's to be expected. It's been a long trek, I'll tell you that. But if I've got enough time, I'm going for a beer. Somewhere behind that bus. I'm Eddie Burns. I hope you've enjoyed it. I'll see you again.